Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
So what now? Bob, you say this. Okay, meeting is now in session. If we'll all bow for a prayer, I'm going to have the invocation tonight. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for this opportunity to serve Alamance County. I pray that you will bless this board and give us the wisdom and discernment to make sound, impartial decisions and work together for the common good of Alamance County. We pray for our city leaders and the leaders of our country, Lord, that they will guide us in the same manner as we face a great economic struggle in the coming years. Lord, let us never forget the freedom that we enjoy in this country and keep our soldiers safe as they continue to fight for this freedom. Help us to remember the true meaning of Christmas, which was the birth of Jesus Christ for me. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Public comments. Mr. Shue, you're on here first, and you may come up, please. And let me remind you, this is limited to about 3 minutes. You got that covered. You got a book now.
I just want to show you what our county line is based on. Mm-hmm. What all this math and all this stuff, it's what it's based on.
Okay.
Now, this first page is the act that set the county line. I've been assured it's current, and I've been assured it's valid. Now, I've read another one. Don't get me wrong. There's plenty of them floating around. But this is the one they say is correct. So who knows? I mean, but that it would seem to me. Now, this second page is out of this book, and that's what they're running our county line by, out of this book. Nobody's been down there and seen if this is valid in the state archives, and no certified copies. This, if you will note, is not a survey. It's a minutes of a county commissioner's meeting. It says right here, minutes of a county, Alamance County Commissioner's meeting. So to me, that don't qualify as a survey, and half of these points on here are crazy. Just for instance, the members mentioned the Crawford place. Well, I got sick last week and didn't get to go down there. But it said it run between the kitchen and the house. I know where that house is. If they ain't flooded that Cane Creek Reservoir with that thing, I know where it's at. And so if you look at this last page, you'll see that even the state moved it from their foyer survey. Because it was real convenient. You know, remember last week somebody said they dug up the footing, the foundation put old. Well, and people heaving don't know nothing about it because the new church, they say, sets dead over the old. So we got a man sitting up here, so they found the old foundation. Well, I didn't go in the church to see if there's any pickaxe holes down in the floor. But my understanding of people heaving, they set over it. So what they've done to make it fit appears to me, but it being this says that it is west of the church, they moved the marker from back behind the church out the front of the church to make it fit this. Now, I'm to the place I really don't care what y'all do with county lines. But I'm telling you this, if you trust Orange County, and Mr. Albright said this act does not override the survey, which is, if you call this a survey. But to me, state law would override it. And I have an in-office memo that I think was purposely sent to me from Orange County, Willie Best, to the GIS people, making a case, and you're welcome right down to see it. I ain't going to bring it up here because it's in our office. But it makes a case for moving the line west 3,400 some odd feet. Now, if you want to trust Orange County, fine. But you're welcome right down to see that. What we were best sent. But I think I was supposed to get it and it scared me off, but I've got to the place I don't even care. Because if I'm going to be in Orange County, hey, I might as well be 3,000 some feet into it, you know. But anyway, I'm just asking, whatever y'all do, make sure that it holds up over this act right here. Because if you trust Orange County, You don't, I've lived there about long as I have here, and I trust them less than I do y'all. Somebody you know ain't fond of y'all.
I think that we are planning to meet. We are planning to meet with them, is that right? Have you set that up at all?
We're working on a meeting, a joint meeting, maybe sometime in a work session.
Okay.
Sometime in January.
But whatever, when you sign off, make sure that it holds up to state level, or they're gonna come back and get you.
Do our best, thank you, Mr. Shee. Okay, next is Sue Dayton, I recognize Sue Dayton.
Hello. Good evening, everyone, can you hear me all right? Let me take my glasses off here. Wanted to welcome you, Chairman Massey, and Commissioner now, and Commissioner Boswell, welcome. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to you tonight. I wanted to come tonight before the end of the month. It's a bit late, but I wanted to give you some information about a recent study that was published in USA Today. Did any of you happen to see that, about toxic air emissions at schools throughout the state of North Carolina and the nation?
I think I got an email on that.
Yes, I did send you all something, probably in the flush of your emails. In the report looked at 128,000 public and private schools from around the country, and the bad news is that schools in Alamance County were ranked among the worst in toxic exposures from air emissions from industries. Hillcrest Elementary was ranked in the second percentile, which means that only 1% of the nation's schools had higher toxicity levels. Other schools in Alamance County, Turrentine Middle School ranked 5th, Burlington Day School 10th, Blessed Sacrament 11th, Walter M. Williams High School at 29th. And this is very disturbing. I am an Alamance County resident. I live in Sacsbaugh, and I do work for the Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League. Blue Ridge has been around for about 25 years, assisting communities that are threatened by polluting industry. Some critics have complained that the data that's given to the EPA's toxic release inventory for this particular study understates emissions, and I can tell you right now that in Alamance County alone, there are at least 24 combustion sources from industries that the EMC is currently considering proposing to make exempt from regulating. One of the industries in Alamance County is New South Lumber, and it actually was not the data from their estimated emissions was not included in this report on schools because it didn't report for some reason. But New South has 4 combustion sources, so those emissions were not considered in the school study. In short, I mentioned the EMC wanted to is proposing that there's about 1,400 combustion sources that are currently exempt due to a loophole in the EPA regulations. It was kind of a mess about 10 years ago. And so instead of making this permanent, we would like to see the combustion sources regulated as all, air toxic should be to protect the health of our children and our land, our water, and our communities in our counties around the state. We are in the middle of a public comment period. Deadline is the end of December, and I was a day late in, getting this issue on your agenda. But I put together for you a sample letter to the Division of Air Quality on this combustion source exemption, along with some information on the school study, and with my business card in case you have any other information. And so I'm hoping that you might consider, since you can't consider this as a resolution of any kind or vote on it, that you might consider looking at the information and sending a letter on your own. So
we'll be glad to
thank you.
Your letter.
Thank you
Ms.
so
Dayton,
much.
When was that study done on the schools?
I believe they collected information in 2005, and it was just released. The toxic.
For what period of time did that study go on?
Let's see. David, do you remember what the time period was?
It's based on 2005 data.
Just 2005?
The study has been underway, I guess, for the last year or so, probably.
Right. And I'm happy to resend. I have the link in the information, so you can go directly to the website. And it's very handy. You can actually click on the state, so you can put in, you know, click on North Carolina, put in the county, and then it'll basically pull up all our schools in the county, and you can see for yourselves how each one of them ranks.
Okay.
So it's
okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
You know, okay, next is recognize Peter Childers.
Yes, thank you, sir. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'd like to give my viewpoint on the subject of the Orange Alamance County Line. Firstly, I do not pretend to be a legal expert, but let me say that I am intimately knowledgeable with this issue, as commissioners have already been made aware. In 2002, I successfully sued Orange County in Superior Court without the use of a lawyer on the legal location of my property. My suit argued, and the court agreed, that my property's legal location was based on the original legal line survey description and the landmarks therein still existing today as depicted by the United States Geological Survey. I also want to add that I also successfully sued Orange County under the illegal tax statute related to the legal location of my property. This issue has been in discussion by the counties for more than 10 years. Every year that passes puts more people and properties in dispute and legal limbo. As commissioners know, General Statute 153A18 can only be used to resolve uncertain or disputed boundaries. This year, the counties requested, by resolution, the North Carolina Geodetic Survey locate the county line by resurvey. I have read the resolution and find paragraph 3 in conflict with the evidence in my case, as well as the resurvey just done by the NCGS. Orange County did not present any evidence in court that supported their version of the county line location, or that my evidence was insufficient to locate the county line. In fact, Orange County's own records show their staff agreed during discussions with Alamance County staff in 1996, and the evidence presented then, that the best line location was that depicted by the United States Geological Survey, Service. The NCGS's recent extensive research and survey now confirms the earlier investigation by the USGS, which shows the historical legal surveyed line's location as described with landmarks in the original survey of 1851. If the county's line location was in question or uncertain before the survey by the NCGS, it is certainly not now, regardless of the wording used in paragraph 3 of the resolution, which states in part, the geographic or landmark references are insufficient to demarcate where the boundary between the two counties lies. If this were argued in court, the counties would have to present countervailing evidence that contradicts the line location as depicted by both authorities. The courts would not accept as evidence of the county line's location arbitrary tax status determined by county tax collectors, the wishes of landowners, or the whims of county commissioners. At present, the county boundary is no longer uncertain, and there is no other legal line in effect, despite what tax collectors and a few disgruntled residents might want. Under General Statute 153A17, I quote, the boundaries of each county shall remain as presently established until changed in accordance with law. The formation of Alamance County was an act of the North Carolina General Assembly. And right now, the only authority that can legally change the Alamance-Orange County line, given the overwhelming evidence of its location and the authorities who support that, is the state legislature. Changing the present surveyed line through the legislature would require a new, expensive survey paid for by the counties. Counties would also be held counties would also be held by Article 5, Section 2 of the North Carolina Constitution, which states, in part, the power of taxation shall be exercised in a just and equitable manner. Subsequently, it can be argued that the counties are in violation of General Statute 153A 149, and I quote, pursuant to Article 5, Section 2.5 of the Constitution of North Carolina, the General Assembly confers upon each county in this state the power to levy, within the limitations set out in this section, taxes on property having a situs within the county. Presently, both counties could be sued under the illegal tax statute. I also will bring to the Commissioner's attention General Statute 105-380, which states the governing body of a taxing unit is prohibited from releasing, refunding, or compromising all or any portion of the taxes levied against any property within its jurisdiction. This statute has the potential to hold the governing body of taxing unit personally liable for those taxes. It appears some commissioners are now dissatisfied with the outcome of the NCGS's survey. They are or seem unwilling to press forward with the survey's cost-effective resolution by accepting the historical legal line that the NCGS relocated at their request. And I realize that commissioners think they are doing the right thing by trying to satisfy a few angry residents. But if commissioners attempt to resolve this dispute by privileging some residents to choose their own county, they will have to allow all residents along the line the same choice, or put the counties in further legal jeopardy. I would also point out that Guilford County is watching closely on how the Orange-Alamance line is determined. What's more, I am amazed that normal tax-conscious Alamance County commissioners are now considering spending county tax money on more surveys to unnecessarily locate the county line for only 27 homes.
Can you give us a copy of that?
I will. During a time when commissioners have denied county departments budgetary requests. Let me point out that it has cost taxpayers, state taxpayers, that's you and me, about $8,000 to have the NCGS survey establish again the historical and legal county line location. And the counties, because they don't like the outcome, want to waste that money spent and pursue an even more costly resolution. Are county commissioners aware of how many food bank meals $8,000 could have purchased? Now some county commissioners want the state legislature to redraw the county line based on arbitrary tax status, which will require an exhaustive and new comprehensive survey with a potential cost estimated by the NCGS at $800,000 to be borne this time by county taxpayers. With disintegrating budgets and economic hardship, I ask, is this the action of responsible government? This dispute needs to end. County commissioners need to make the tough choice that will not satisfy all the landowners and consider all the taxpayers in the county. Using the legal surveyed line is cost-effective, removes endless arguments of unfairness of who should be located where, rebuts favoritism charges, and avoids further legal issues. I don't know what it will take for this to be eventually resolved, but the resolution now is clear. Follow the law and recognize and use the surveyed existing historical legal line, and out of fairness to those displaced taxpayers, grandfather them into use of existing county services they will lose until their property changes hands.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I'll put this into the record, and I have an extra copy. How does this? You want a copy of yours for yourself, or are you going to use
it? She can give me one.
Okay, that'd be fine. Thank you, Commissioner. Mm-hmm. Good evening.
Thank you. Are there any other public comments? No. Okay, the next thing is Ms. Lowy. If you'll come forward, please. Ms. Lowy is with Cobb Ziegler Lowy & Company, and she's going to give us our annual financial report.
Good evening. I appreciate the opportunity to be here, and of course we do as a firm appreciate the opportunity to perform the audit for you. We realize you do have a choice on who you choose to do your audit for you, and we appreciate the opportunity. As you have before, you actually have two packets before you. You have one very thick one, which is your full annual comprehensive annual financial report. As always, I do recommend that you read that. There's a lot of information in that report that is history of the county. There's lots of statistics and things that might help just pull a lot of different ideas together about what's reported there and how it's reported. So I do recommend that you read that. But to make things a little easier to understand where you are financially, I have graphed a lot of the key information for you. I'll start by saying that you did have an unqualified opinion. When we look at the audit, we look at your policies and procedures. We make sure you have the right ones in place, and we make sure that they're operating the way they're supposed to, so that when Amy and the finance department gives us the numbers to populate the report, we believe that it's materially represents the financial activity of the county. And so we do believe that the report accurately presents the financial activity of Alamance County. If you look at the graph on page one, this is your general fund. Of course, your general fund is your operating fund for the county. That's where most of your revenue and expenditures are going to be. This is modified accrual basis, which means that it's basically the basis that you operate with on a month-to-month basis. And so it's the numbers that you're used to seeing. We do at the end of the year book accruals for receivables and payables, but for the most part, this is what you're used to seeing every month. If you look at your total revenue this year, it's $126 million compared to $118 million last year. That's an $8.3 million increase in your revenue. Your revenue went up by $8.3 million. Taxes account for $2.8 million. The jail fees account for $4 million. EMS accounts for $800,000, and your sales tax accounts for $1 million. That's of the increase. So you have last year's numbers, but over last year's, you actually increased that by 8.3. You budgeted a total of $125,760,000. You actually received $126 million. So you're almost $1 million, you're about $500,000 over your expected revenue. Your budget's only a guide. It's what you hope to get, but it is only a guide. You actually exceeded what you expected to receive. On your expenditures, $124 million compared to $116 million. So your expenditures also went up by $8 million. There's two or three categories that had large increases. Public safety, the jail and sheriff department had $1.6 million. Public safety in total at $2 million. Education was $3 million, and most of that was the school system. The other areas were just a little bit of an increase from in several different areas. I won't go over all those details. You budgeted $131 million. You spent $124 million. So, again, you expended a lot less than what you budgeted. So what that means is that the freeze, the cost containment procedures that you put in place worked. You budgeted $131 million, you spent $124 million. Now I'm going to tell you, like I have in the past, that is what we see typically with Alamance County. A very conservative budget. You've got to have it budgeted or you can't spend it. So you budget what you'd like to have. You budget what you need to have. Whether or not you spend it this year or next year, sometimes the timing can be adjusted. So the budget's there. But typically, Alamance County does not spend that full budget. You have vacancies that aren't filled. You have different things that come up that delay an expenditure for one reason or another. So that's typical that we see that Alamance County does not always spend what they budget. But this year, it's more than what I would say we normally see. $8 million is quite a bit less than what you budgeted. So if you take the $126 million minus the $124, you have an excess of $2.4 million. $2.4 is your excess revenue over expense. And so what that means is that you actually generated more revenue than expense. All those measures that you put in place to try to contain your costs have worked. That puts you in a good position for where we are going in the economy. I know everybody's worried about what's going to happen with the revenues. Your expenses, some of them you can't contain them. You cannot cut services. You cannot take less deputies off the street. You cannot do those kind of things that impact public safety or the services that you're required to render. So you have to look at your actual revenues. The tough part is putting a budget together, because you have to guess where you think sales tax is going to be, where you think all of your numbers are going to be. You have to guess. But don't forget that your budget is just a guide. It's just a guide. It is not where you are. Where you are is where your actual revenue is and your actual expense is. So as you go forward into your budget process and try to figure out what you need to do, first of all, know that you're starting at a good point. You're at a good point right now. When you look at that budget, do your best guess, put it on paper where you think you're going to be, do all of the process, the cutting, the vacancies, whatever your normal process is, get that budget on paper. But remember, the key is where your actual numbers are. If your revenue's coming in higher or lower than expected, you might have to do something on the expenditure side. But what you really have to be concerned about is your actual revenue and your actual expense, not where you are with budget, because the budget can always be amended. Things change as you go, and none of us know where things are going to end up. So as you go through that process, just remember that it is good to be conservative as you set that budget, but typically Alamance County does not spend what they budget. And so that has helped me to feel a lot more comfortable about where the budget is, appropriated fund balance. I've been asked in the past, we've got this huge appropriated fund balance. What does that mean? Doesn't mean anything if you don't use it. If you don't go into that appropriated fund balance, it's just a balancing amount. If you don't go into it, it just balances your budget for you. So don't get too upset about the budget piece. Monitor your revenue, your actual revenue, and your actual expense. I just want to give you a couple of things about your taxes. Your taxes went up $2.8 million this year. Of course, your rate went up a little bit. That accounts for part of that. Your value went up a little bit. You're at $10.5 billion in property value. That's a 2% increase over last year. Every 1 cent of your tax rate generates $1 million in tax revenue. Your collection percentage was 97.99%. That is ad valorem only. That is the second worst tax collection that you've had since 2000. Now, if you think about the variance, it's only about a 1% variance. Your highest was 98.99%. So it is going to fluctuate depending on different factors, but right now it's at 97.99%. Statewide, 98.36%. Statewide for North Carolina, 98.36% is the collection percentage, so you're not far from that percentage. Counties with population over 100,000, which is where you all are, the collection percentage is 98.73%. So for counties over 100, you are less than where the average is. The other interesting item on your tax rate is what your interest income, how that equates to what your tax rate is. This year your interest income is $1.6 million. Last year it was $2.7 million, so it went down. Of course, we would all expect that because of the economy. But you also had less cash in your capital projects. Depending on what's going on when the money's actually spent, you can have a fluctuation in your actual cash. Last year you had $20 million. This year you had $10 million. So that both of those pieces accounted for the part of the reduction in your interest income. But it's equivalent to 1.51 cents on your tax rate. The interest income is equivalent to 1.51 cents. Last year it was equivalent to 3 cents. So that's, you hate to see that, and hopefully we'll see recovery in that, but that is what it's equivalent to. Now you're probably wondering how I got all that information out of this one little chart. The thing to really focus on here is that you had an excess. And if you look across the bottom, you can see that's the trend. You've got positives and negatives, but right now it's you're in a good position. And so that's the key to take away from this chart. I'll go through the others a little bit quicker. The landfill is the next one. The landfill revenue is $3.6 million. That is an increase of $69,000, so pretty much in line with last year's. The expenditures are $2.276 compared to $2.4 last year. Your costs have gone down in total by $186,000. The biggest piece of that is your post-closure closing cost. When we started looking into what that's an estimated figure, how much is it going to cost me to close the landfill, what all has to be done, and what's that going to cost, and you take a nice big calculation and look at the land that you're talking about, and we actually had some additional information with the new engineering report this year, and so we looked a little bit closer at that calculation, and we modified it a little bit, and we feel like we've got a better calculation on it, but that ended up producing a negative cost this year. We're at $7.4 million that's been put back for that post-closure. And so we feel like that's a very good number. $7.4 million is a lot of money when you're looking at $2.2 in current operating, and you wouldn't have all those same costs. That's a pretty big number to do that closing. And so we took the new engineering report, and we sat down with the engineer. We sat down with the Mr. Thomas and went over those. We went over it with Alvin and tried to formulate that, and it always felt like it was a very large number. And so we wanted to make sure that we had a good number there. And so we did dig through that a little bit more this year. So 7.4 is what your total liability is for that post-closing. You have a total of $11 million in cash that's in that fund. So if you take that liability away, you're sitting at $3.6 million in your fund balance. That's what's available. Your total net assets is $17.3 million, but a lot of that's tied up in fixed assets. They're all the equipment, buildings, whatever's out there, that's $13.1 million, and that comes back to your net assets available, which is your 3.6. So again, you ended up in a very good position. That's $1.8 million is your excess in that fund, so $1.8 million. We expect to see that calculation yield an expense from here on. That the calculation this year was just to modify it to start with, but you will see an expense going in there, I would suspect, from now on, so you're not going to be in as good a position as it is right now. So that won't stay that way, but it is very strong for this year. Your employee insurance funds and your workman's comp funds, these are in here because for years I had to say it doesn't look good. I guess, I don't know, I need to keep monitoring those, of course, but as you can see, they look great. Your revenue went up significantly. If you look from 2001 forward, it's gone up significantly in that time frame. But as everybody else probably would attest to, the health costs have gone up tremendously for all of us. And so your revenue's gone up almost $300,000, which is 4%. Your expense has gone up $787,000, which is 13%. And of course, you know that's the number that you can't control at all. And so the key here is, again, to look at actual revenue and expense. You have to be able to react to something that causes those expenses to go up. Your total net asset, your total excess this year is $2.2 million. And so your fund balance now is at $6 million. Now, 4 years ago, it was at $830,000. And you're at $6 million now. So what does that mean? Well, it means you're at a good place. You're at a good place right now. Does that mean you should cut those premiums? I don't know. I'm conservative. I'm an auditor, and you don't need to keep building and building and building, but it doesn't take much to drive those costs up. So I think you're at a good point. Now, what you do from here forward, because you can't do anything about the expenditures, you're just going to have to continue to monitor it. I think you're beyond the crisis stage, which I felt like we were at a few years ago. So looks very good. Your workman's comp on page 4 is the same way. You have $1 million in revenue. Now, some of that is some reinsurance that was received. When your premiums go over a certain amount, you do have an insurance policy that kicks in some premiums there. So your real increase, your real premium volume is $805,000. So as you can see, that too has taken big jumps, and that's because the county's funding that, putting the money in there. But that's what it takes to get, that's what it took to get those funds where they needed to be. The expenditure is $677,000. That's an increase of $187,000. So that gives you an excess of $364,000. Fund balance is $926,000. So your fund balance is almost at $1 million. Your cost this year, it was $677,000, but you had a big claim. That's your average is going to be much less than that. So hopefully that is not normal for you, and you won't continue to see expense like that. But still, 926 is a lot better than where you were. We started 4 years ago at 493. So you have been able to build into that fund as well. And so I commend you on those efforts. You have been able to put those funds in a lot better shape. And from here forward, again, you're just going to have to continue to monitor revenue and expense and where that takes you. Okay, page 5 is a lot of numbers, and I'm not going to go over all those. The top part we've already talked about. It's the revenues. I gave you the original budget, the final budget, the actual, the variance, the difference between your final budget and your actual, and then compared it to the prior year. I'll let you look at those. The key on this report is your fund balance. Where is the fund balance? I told you your excess was $2.4 million, and that takes you to a fund balance of $30,633,000. If I look at the middle of the graph, all these numbers, I know it's a lot to look at, but if I look at the middle, over on the far right is your total fund balance for your general fund. And if you look, you've got 9 years worth of data there. You're at your highest at $30 million. Your lowest was $20 million, and so you've built, over these years, you've built an increase of $10,000 from your lowest. From June 30, 2000, you've actually added $5 million to your bottom line. The good thing about this is that as you build that fund balance, it drives some of your percentages that you're going to see below here. The LGC requires that you have 8% of your expenditures available and unreserved fund balance. Now, I said you had $30 million in total fund balance. All of that is not unreserved. $11 million of that is reserved by state statute, and that's basically it's assets that you don't have in cash yet. They're not going to let you consider it as cash because it's not in hand yet. And so they take that out when they do this calculation. Your total unreserved fund balance is $18.9 million. You are required to have $9.9 million, so you're almost double what you're required to have. So you're good in that calculation. If you even started getting close to that, the LGC would start communicating with you and asking you what you're going to do and how you're going to fix that. The bottom of this chart is comparing to other counties and comparing to all of the counties over 100,000, the 10 closest in size, and then Alamance County. Your actual percentage is 15.22. You're at 15.22% of your expenditures. You've got to be at 8. You're at 15.22. If I look at all the counties over 100,000, they're at 20.59, so you're a little less than the other counties. Now, some of those are very large counties, and so it's not comparing apples to apples necessarily. So that's why I went to the 10 closest. That's 22.29. So they're actually in even better position if you take the 10 closest in size. The reason Alamance County's percentage has dropped is because your expenditures are going up. And as your expenditures go up, if your fund balance, if the increase to fund balance doesn't increase at the same rate, then your percentage is going to go down. So that's what's driving your percentage down, is because your fund balance hasn't been the same either, exactly the same, but the bigger piece here is that your expenditures have gone up. If I look at the rate for 06, it's 100, your expenditures were 107. This year they're 124. You've got 107 2 years ago, 116 last year, and 124. So your expenditures are going up at a higher rate than you're adding to your fund balance. So that is something to look at, but as long as you're adding to your fund balance and you're not close to that 8%, I think you're in good shape for what that calculation is there for. It is a guide as well. So you're really in good shape when you look at these numbers. If I take the $550,000 out that you spent on the building over here, that would take your percentage to 14.78. So if you had done that as of June 30th, you'd be at 14.78. Again, as long as you're adding to your fund balance, that means you're taking in more money than you're spending. And as long as you're doing that, I think you're in a good position. I talked briefly a minute ago about the appropriated fund balance. You're always going to have that because you've got to balance your budget, and most of the time you're going to have a number there. In all the years that you've budgeted use of fund balance, you've only used it 4 years, and that's been since 2000. I'm looking at the numbers that are on your chart. Since 2000, you've budgeted every year use of fund balance. You've only used it 4 years, and those 4 years, you only used $7.4 million. Now, $7.4 million sounds like a lot, but you budgeted $25 million, a use of $25, and you only used $7.4. There are going to be times when you've got to do something because of the timing or the circumstances. You need to do it, and you need to go into fund balance to do it. And that's just being smart. And so it's not a bad thing to use that fund balance, but if you go year after year after year and use it, that's when you're not going to be in a position that you're going to start dropping that percentage, and it's going to be a concern to the LGC, and I don't like to see that go down either. Your numbers are good. You're in good shape right now, especially given that we're getting ready to go into be hit by the economy, by what's going on with the sales tax. Everybody's concerned about that. Nobody knows what's going to happen. But again, I would say make sure you're looking at your actual revenues and expenditures. You got to set up that budget, and I know it's going to be really hard to do that. You're going to have to set that budget, but as long as your actual revenue is more than your expense, you're okay. As long as you're not spending money that you're not bringing in, you're okay.
Can you refer to the average tax rate of the counties our size, and do you consider a weighted figure when you look at those? Or?
This is not a weighted figure.
Okay.
This is not a weighted figure.
So please tell us about our average.
Well, you're actually in pretty good shape compared to these. If you look at what I've got here, Randolph County's 54, Davidson's 54, Cabarrus is 63, and Pitt County's 70. And so if you look at your tax rate, and I apologize, I rounded your last year's tax rate, it's actually 0.575, and then this year at 0.58, and so you're very comparable to where the others are, unless the other two, I mean, those are significantly higher than where you are. So,
and the two that you mentioned, Davidson and Randolph, if they merged their school systems, we would be the bottom, because they can't merge their school systems and not have a much higher tax rate than what we've got.
And
that's a key that a lot of people don't realize about their rates. And they did reevaluation in Davidson County and didn't drop the tax rate a penny.
Yep.
Not a penny. And how they got by with that, I'll never know. But they have not gone through school merger in either of those two counties.
Mm-hmm. Well, you will see that your rate will probably go down and start building its way back up. That's kind of the trend as you go through reevaluation. That's the way it works. I haven't heard a whole lot of positive comments about what that's going to generate in the future, but hopefully there will still be growth there, and that will allow you to leave it where it is or be able to manage with it.
Davidson's fund, I have to tell this. We went down, Tim and I went down, and their fund balance was just exorbitant compared to what you would think they might have in there. And I knew they hadn't cut their tax rate in the last reevaluation. And I looked across the table. Remember when we asked him about how that fund balance grew so large? And then when he had to answer that they didn't cut the tax rate at all when they had reevaluation, he grinned and said that was obviously how they pulled that off. But I said, how did you sell the public to that? And he said, well, we did tell them that at least we're going to have the money now that we're going to need to do the things that we need to do when we need to do it, if you want to try to sell that barrel of apples. But
those are all the things you have to look at when you're looking at your capital projects, what needs to be done and how you're going to pay for them. Those are all those factors that have to be considered. It's going to probably be a difficult budget year this year to try to figure out how all those numbers are going to work out. But as far as your financial position, you're in good shape right now, and I hope that continues. I do expect to see some changes. Your local option sales tax went up $1 million this year. I have seen it go up a lot more than that in years, so it's probably already leveling off. It was already leveling off at that point, but you may see some decrease there, and I don't know how you're going to budget for that. I don't know how you're going to have to look at where you are right now and what the increases and decreases have been right now. I don't know what Amy's system is capable of doing. We actually have a five-year trend that we can print out of our system that just gives you the trend across the table. And so it's kind of helpful if you can look at that, where you started versus where you are now, what kind of increases you've experienced, to try to give you some kind of guide on what you think a decrease might be. You're still guessing. There's still no way to know. But the best source is what your actual figures have been and what they are right now from month to month. Where you are right now is going to be your best source to try to make those determinations. So you are in good shape.
If our collection rate was at the state average, how much more money would that be? Roughly $400,000? Would that be about right? Or
that's close. I would have said about a little less than that, maybe 300.
380, something like that. Mm-hmm. What are we thinking is the cause of that? Is it car tax, the lack of success on car, auto?
The rates I gave you are just ad valorem.
Just real estate?
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right.
Yes,
so it's not cars then. That's the excuse. It's collection.
I would, anytime you have a new system that can create problems, I think that procedures could be looked at for collecting back taxes. I don't know what, you know, I don't know how aggressively those are pursued. Those are all things that can be considered when you look at that tax rate. The economy can impact that, and so I hope that's not an indication that they're going to be slower coming in, but that can be an impact also.
Well, state average is state average. I mean, we ought to at least be at state average.
Any more questions?
I have a couple more things I'm going to go over with you. If you look at the page right after your graph, it's page numbered as CO8. I apologize, I didn't repage the number of the report. These are just a couple of comments that we had when we were doing our audit. When we audit the compliance with DSS and all of your mates, it's basically DSS because they get so much of your grant money. We do audit a few of the other pots of money that you get from federal, state government, but most of the money that we are required to audit is in your Department of Social Services. And we did have a couple of findings there. The first one was timesheets and day sheets that did not match. I actually have to account for every minute of my day, so I understand how difficult it is when you're doing two different systems to capture all the information there. And that is one of the pieces that we are required to test, and so we have to make sure they match. And there were a couple instances where they did not match. And so we consider that an issue, because if they don't match and that's not corrected, it can become a funding issue. We have sat down with Susan and Richard and have gone through what we found, the errors that we found, and what can be done to try to correct those. And we do believe that they have put some new systems in training. It basically comes down to the use of a non-billable code and how everybody's using that. And there has been some inconsistencies between the state and then departments within the state, and it's been inconsistent between everybody. And so what they are going to do is look at developing a policy for Alamance County, taking all the information they've gotten and developing a policy for Alamance County, so hopefully they can all follow that same policy. The next page has the other comment on it. That is that there was a file that was closed that should not have been. We pull a lot of files. For every major program that we audit, we have to look at least 25 files, and a lot of times it's more files than that. And so we look for all of the required forms. We look at the internal controls that are used to accumulate all that information, and we did find one file that had been closed that should not have been, and that can be a problem if things are being done that are not supposed to be. So it was an oversight. There was no specific issue that we could point to, but they have looked at that finding and will implement a procedure to make sure that that doesn't happen in the future. Those were the only two findings, and so that is good. We do, like I said, look at the internal control, and we try to make sure that it's good and strong for all of that grant money that comes in. The last thing you have is a letter, and I'm just going to real briefly go over it. I know you have a full agenda tonight. We do audit under U.S. Generally Accepted Auditing Standards. We also audit under OMB Circular A133, which is the compliance piece of what we have to look at. We look at the internal controls over the financial reporting and over compliance to make sure that the information that you're receiving in your financial, that's being reported in your financial report, is accurate and allows us to make an unqualified opinion. It supports the opinion that we render. We do test that compliance. We don't look at everything. Obviously, we could never do that, but we test it. We go look at invoices. We go look at controls and policies that are being used, and we make sure they're operating correctly. We also look at estimates, and in this letter, on page 2 of this letter, I wanted to bring a couple of things to your attention. You implemented a collection policy with your EMS, and with what we have seen, first of all, we had $800,000 more in collections. Well, one of the things that we do when we get the audit is we look at the receivable. It's a huge receivable sitting there, but it's not fully collectible. It never is. It never has been. We look at the collection percentage and apply that to the receivable. So we look at the past years and how much was collected for each of those past years to develop an accurate percentage on what is being collected, what percent is being collected. And that's what's shown as your receivable. So if you've seen an EMS receivable report that says $5 million, it's written down to a reasonable to the collection percentage that each of the prior years have produced. So it's not going to be at $5 million, but that's because it's never fully collectible. The other item that I wanted to bring to your attention, again, it has to do with estimates, is the landfill closure and post-closure liability. We do, that is an estimate. It is not a known number. We estimate that, and there are calculations out there. There are several different calculations, and we use all of them really to develop what we believe is the best estimate on what that liability is. On page three, these are just a few things I need to communicate with you. We did not have any difficulties in performing the audit. We do look at the journal entries. Under the corrected and uncorrected misstatements, we actually look at journal entries and why we're doing them. If we're converting modified accrual to full accrual, those aren't any kind of misstatements. Those are just converting from modified to full. And so those journal entries don't indicate that there's any issues. But if we were doing journal entries to correct things, to reclassify things, to fix problems, that could be indication that the system's not working well. And we did not have anything like that. So the journal entries did not indicate problems in your controls. We did not have any disagreements with management. We did get a management representation letter that says that they provided all the requested information to us and that the information was accurate and that there was no fraud noted from their work or from our work. We also were not made under consultations with other independent accountants. If you decided, management decided they wanted a second opinion, the other auditors are supposed to contact us to make sure they have all the relevant information, and we were not contacted. Other audit findings and issues, the only thing I wanted to do was bring to your attention one other piece of information. In your financial statements, the first two schedules are the new GASB 34 schedules. They are full accrual schedules, and so they capture everything that's due to you, not just the current financial resources. They capture everything. So your debt is there. Your fixed assets for your general fund are there. Well, you all know you don't ever see that on a normal basis, but a few years ago they made us add that to your statement. If you look at that statement, you're also going to see a very large negative fund balance, and I just wanted to remind you why it's like that. Your negative net assets is because you take the debt for the schools and the schools take the asset. So they look really good and you look really bad because on that full accrual, you have all that debt. And so until that debt is gone, you're going to have that kind of negative fund balance, or at least until you catch up with the fund balance that you've generated without those assets. So I just wanted you to know that. If you look at your statement, you're going to see that and wonder what that is. The last thing you've got in here is a memo from the LGC. That's where a lot of those statistics the tax rates, the statewide information, that's where that comes from. And I just wanted to put that in there so that you would have that handy in case you want to look for some other information. There's a lot of good information in here, and it is by county, so you can actually go look at it any county you want to and pull that information on those specifically. But like Mr. Sutton said, sometimes you have to know what's going on with that county because they may not be comparable. So I would, if you decide you want to look at those, that's something that you would probably want to look into a little bit to get more details about what's going on in that county.
How did you base picking the files from DSS?
We do random searches. Mm-hmm. We actually, we get all the reports. We pick a month, we get their report for that month, and we go through, and haphazardly is the technical term. We take we start with the 20th and take every 10th or something like that. So
I've been involved in that before.
So it is,
that's why I wanted to make sure how
we don't pick
it.
Names we know or anything like that. It is a set pattern on how we pick those.
Right. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
Thank you, Becky.
Thank you.
Again, I do appreciate your time, and I want to tell you all that we appreciate the help that we get from Finance and Mr. Smith. They spend a lot of time and answer a lot of questions. We can ask a lot of questions about what's going on and how things are, and without their help digging all that information out, it would be very difficult for us to do the audit. And so we do very much appreciate all the work that they do and the help that they give us.
It's a long process.
It is.
It is.
It is.
I think this is the best report I remember in the last 4 years.
It's a very good report. Okay. It is. A lot of it, when we do those receivables, we picked up a big receivable from the jail. And you would expect that. He didn't tell me to say that, I promise you.
Why take grand off?
Well, when you've got $4 million in additional revenue, that also picked up that receivable, and so it changed where you started from, because it was a receivable that you didn't have in cash yet. Mm-hmm. And so it kind of changed the way it looked when you had the report for June. And so that's kind of what made it look so good right there at the end. But that's a good thing.
Bob, did you get that?
Oh, no.
Thank you. Okay, next thing on our agenda is Mr. Rich at Jail Food Service Contract Request.
Hello, everyone, and glad to see two new members.
Thank you.
Met you and had good conversations with you.
Thank you.
I'm here to talk to you about the food service at the jail. We have Canteen Correctional Services, our vendor. We have a representative here named Tom Phillips from Canteen, and he's here if you have any questions of him after I get through. And I'll be brief as possible. We do have a contract with them, and it was a two-year contract, and we signed it in September 2007. It runs till the end of November 2009. In that contract, there's a clause that allows Canteen to ask for an increase in the per meal rate, and it would be equal to the consumer price index increase. If the price of food goes up, they ask for an increase, and I can understand that. They have asked for an increase. They asked us in November for an increase of 6% to go into effect this month, December, and that would have been an additional cost per month of close to about $4,000. We told them no, but we told them that we need to go in front of UP for that reason. We didn't have the money. That was the biggest reason. And we're nearly halfway through the budget year, and the money's not there. So as a way to ease the blow to our budget, they I guess they came back with another proposal, and they've asked for 3% and to go into effect January until July, basically a six-month increase. And it would go into effect in January, as I told you, and it would in July they would want to revisit the per meal rate. In other words, instead of having to absorb the whole 6%, they want us to see if we can stomach, I guess you'd say, the 3%. And in July, they want to see what we can come up with. And we'll be able to budget at that time, I guess is the idea here. Again, hard figures. And these are estimated figures, by the way. When I tell you how much per month, we have to go by how many meals we have to serve. And the average is what I'm telling you. And as the money is not there currently in the budget, I'm asking the board here, and the sheriff, I'm sure, is asking you that, for guidance on how to handle the request. And again, Mr. Phillips is there if you have any questions of him. And that was short and sweet.
Any comments?
When was it last negotiated again?
We negotiated September 2007 and went in effect in December 2007.
Okay.
So we're a little over a year into it in a two-year contract.
What percentage of almost on a daily basis, what percentage of the detainees are ICE or Marshals, where we could be reimbursed for that increase and not local? That may be a
lot.
Sheriff,
I'd
question.
Say over 50, probably.
Over 50%. Mm-hmm. Would that roll over?
We're getting ready to renegotiate in April with Marshals and ICE on for them, or bed rate, and at that time, all that would be taken into consideration. If it's voted on tonight, give them that 3%, then that 3% would be figured into the next negotiations.
And by the way, I failed to tell you, the 3% would be around $12,000 for the six-month period, but you can do the math. Any other questions?
Any comments?
You want to ask Mr. Phillips anything?
He's a pretty tough negotiator, isn't he?
He wanted 6. We wouldn't give him 6, but I told him I'd come in front of him for 3.
Well, if you turned down the 3, would have come back at 1.5.
That's right.
I don't know.
We were going in the right direction there. We realize when we go to the store.
Question is, the 3% is not out of line at all.
Preston, you're up next, don't you?
And I'll promise I'll keep this quick. moving along. Those of you that were on the board at the last budget retreat, you probably will remember that I spoke about the Stormwater Smart program that we were involved in under a 3-year contract. And this year, that contract came up. The Stormwater Smart Program was an educational program that the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments administered for Alamance County, and primarily their stormwater education and soil and erosion control education was directed towards middle school children, elementary school children. They focused very heavily on that front, and at the time I felt that we, given the trend of development in Alamance County, we were having development occur at a little bit faster rate than maybe some of the other counties, or at least on par with some of the larger counties. I felt that we would be well served to look at alternatives when that contract came up. And when it did, actually on the recommendation of our former planner, Kerry Hobson, who was very educated in stormwater matters, recommended that we look at the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership, and being that we were tied into a contract, we couldn't really pursue it at that point, but kind of kept that in the back of my head and then pursued that this year. The Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership is a stormwater education program that is administered primarily through the city of Greensboro, through Lavelle Donnell and her staff there in Greensboro. They put a lot of funding on the city level into this. And as you see, there are several other local governments that have signed into an interlocal agreement with them. And included with that, their training and education is more directed towards builders, developers, construction workers. It's more directed in that direction. I think both are outstanding programs. At the time, I felt that the cost of the Stormwater Smart Program was a bit high compared to this. This program, to enter into this interlocal agreement, will cost us $3,000 a year as opposed to approximately $4,500 a year. So we were able to get a little bit of savings in this as well. And I think their materials are outstanding. Unfortunately, I don't have any with me because they're in the process of reprinting and everything else, but they're much more colorful and much more illustrative. Also, they do some TV ads, which you may see occasionally on Channel 2 and some of the local access channels that run in Greensboro, and that would also be a service that would be provided to the county as well. So with that, I'll be glad to take any questions. I will say that this interlocal agreement is a five-year interlocal agreement that would need to be renewed after 5 years. It does have a termination clause in it, with either party can submit in writing within 90 days and terminate the contract. As I said, I think both programs, the COG runs an outstanding program. I'm not going to badmouth the COG. In a perfect world, we would love to have both, but I have to look at what's best for the county and the money that we have to spend. So I think this is the better program.
Jason, how often does that committee meet?
I believe the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership, I believe it's on a quarterly basis. And I would be the representative, staff representative on that.
I had one question on it, Jason.
Sure.
And it says Randleman Lake Stormwater Management Plan down there under whereas. I'm a little confused on that. Right on the first page.
Oh, on the first
there,
page.
Under the witnesses.
Yeah.
And I was just curious as to where that, I mean, how that really affects us.
Well, I think this more or less affects the city of Greensboro, and it more affects Guilford County. It would not affect us as much. We don't obtain water supplies from there. So.
Okay, that's what I was confused about.
All these people are associated with the Piedmont Triad.
Yeah.
That's
exactly.
The whole nine yards right there.
Yeah.
And the COG, when they meet, I knew about that too. Okay.
Yeah, and I believe up until this year, the town of Elon was as well. And they may be renewing, I'm not sure. But
okay. City of Burlington, are they part of this group also?
No, they are with the Stormwater Smart Program.
Okay. Currently.
They're listed in here too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
No.
All right. We need to need a motion to accept this agreement.
Motion.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, next is Sheriff Johnson and Susan Ott. And this is, has to do with the establishment of Family Justice Center. And it's grant funded.
Yes, ma'am.
That's good words.
Back in the fall of 2008, the commissioners appropriated, much appreciated by the sheriff's department and by the community, the old DSS building in Martin Street, some space there for a Family Justice Center. And we are very, very excited about that. About the same time, the sheriff received notification that a grant that we had written jointly was funded through the Governor's Crime Commission to support a position for the Family Justice Center director. And we are here after a recommendation from the Personnel Commission Committee on 12-8 to ask that that be established. Sheriff, he's been assisting us with personnel up to this point.
Yeah. We're asking that the position be established for a director that will be paid out of the grant funding, and any other cost to it would be provided by some of the independent agencies involved.
Okay.
We have some local funding through some foundations. Wishart and Norris Foundation have donated some money, so we feel like we have this funded at no county cost.
This will be one of the greatest things, I think, that happened in Alamance County, the Family Justice Center.
Can we explain that a little bit in case of people? If you don't mind.
Family Justice Center, of course, we have a tremendous problem in this county with our child abuse, domestic violence here in Alamance County. What has happened previously is individuals, the victims of domestic violence, has to go to the magistrate, to the clerk, to here, to family abuse services, to there. By doing the Family Justice Center, it will all be under one roof. Law enforcement agencies from every county from every agency in the county will be working out of the Family Justice Center, along with social services, Dena George Group,
Crossroads,
and Family Abuse Services. And hopefully, eventually, there will be, we can either do it over internet, get 50 B's issued by the judges and back in there and be ready to go out and serve these. And hopefully someday, maybe even a magistrate will occupy that office to help issue proper papers to take this individual in custody. I know when I first came in office, I think our first five homicides were domestic violence related. And it has since curbed tremendously, but we still got a long ways to go.
And this is a two-year grant, and it is renewable.
Is that building, is it fixed? I mean, so you can use it?
The county is fixing it up, and we're very pleased with what y'all have allowed us to do over, and this is just a start, and I think we'll be okay.
What's the completion date? Is it March or April on that building?
It's the summer.
I think June or July.
Remember the media asked.
Probably June or July.
Probably early fall.
Any other questions?
I'm gonna make a comment on this job description. and wow.
Well, there are model family justice centers across the nation, and we patterned this after one of several of those.
And you're gonna have good luck in filling that one.
Yes.
They'll earn their pay, is that what you're saying?
And that'll be a collaborative process with the Sheriff's Department, because he will house the position.
So you're looking for a motion?
Move. Yep.
Second.
Have a motion, okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Again, one other thing involving the Family Justice Center, if we could just ask, we want to apply for, it'd be a $400,000 over 2 years, a grant. Enforcement protection orders program, arrest and things with the federal government.
Pay for that protective order, electronic protective order.
And exactly. And we feel like we're in a good position to get that grant. All we need is the commissioners.
It's not matching, is it?
No matching.
No matching.
Permission to proceed after that grant. Don't mean we'll get it, but we have to have your permission.
And the county would be the applying agency.
Okay.
I'll make a motion.
Have a motion.
Second.
All All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Next is Mr. Haygood with the, he's going to talk about the Pleasant Grove Recreation Center update.
Good evening, Commissioners. Welcome.
Good evening.
Mr. Massey.
Thank you.
Mr. Boswell. I'm here this evening before you to give you an update on what's going on at the Pleasant Grove Rec Center. This facility is located up near the intersection of Highway 49 and Highway 62 North. This is in Pleasant Grove Township. As the board knows, Pleasant Grove Recreation Center suffered extensive fire and smoke damage back in June of this year, on June 9th specifically. The county and its insurance company have been working to try to determine the scope of the repairs that are needed to bring that building back online. It has been offline since 1st of June. The county staff and the project team have had several meetings and dialogue also, not just with the insurance company, with the, but also with the Alamance-Brown School System, who in fact own the building. The property is owned by Alamance-Brown School System. County leases it to provide recreational service. Just recently, the county has contracted with Routon, Nicholson, and DeLuca to provide architect services and to also manage the renovation project that will take place up there. Now, on this Friday, December 19th, staff from our department, facility maintenance, the architects and their engineers are going out to meet at Pleasant Grove and to go through the building with a fine-tooth comb and try to determine what exactly needs to be done out there to bring the place back online. Hopefully at this meeting, the architects and all the staff in the county will be able to determine what systems should either be repaired or replaced. And just to give you a brief idea, this is not comprehensive, but some of the things that are going to have to be considered for this renovation project include roof repair, the replacement of the gymnasium floor, the tile floor in the basketball gym, structural repair to fire-damaged areas, structural repair to electrical and plumbing systems, the cleaning of walls, ceilings, and all smoke damage, the replacing of damaged lighting, check, clean, and possibly replace the HVAC system that's in place out there now, and also to examine what painting needs may need to be done out there too. Now, after this meeting on Friday, the architects hope that, and believe that they can have a design development drawings by mid-January 2009, and then they should be able to produce biddable documents for this work to be done by the 1st of February. That's what they believe they can put together. And that's what the county has been waiting on, is to put together something that could actually be put out to bid that's comprehensive enough to give contractors an idea of exactly what needs to be done. The county needs that data to stay in line with statutory requirements. Now, depending on the cost of these renovations, once the architects are finished and we have a biddable package, we'll be able to have some idea of what we think the renovation out there will cost in total. That's going to have bearing on the bidding process. It could be an informal bidding process. If it's extensive renovations, it may push it into a formal range. The county's estimating the bid process could take anywhere between 30 and 60 days to actually get the bid out there and lay it and get it settled. Then, without having a comprehensive look right now for you, we estimate at least 120 days to do work once the bid is let, contractors assigned. We're thinking it'll probably be close to 4 months before the work is complete. Therefore, based on that timeline, the department believes Pleasant Grove Recreation Center will hopefully be back online by August of 2009. And that's down the road a little piece. And right now, we still have made arrangements for the programs that were taking place out there to find other homes, with the exception of the Friday night dance. That's the only program that we really have not been able to replace. The space needs, it was such a unique program in Pleasant Grove, it's very difficult to find that kind of space. However, we're continuing to have bingo programs for the senior citizens of the community at the Lakeview Civitan Club. Miles Chapel's also been gracious enough to take in some of the classes that were going on at Pleasant Grove. And the youth basketball has been transferred to Pleasant Grove Elementary School, which is about maybe 3 miles up the street, and also to Hall River Elementary School. We certainly appreciate principals and staff at those two locations taking that program in. We have numerous teams up there. Pleasant Grove was a linchpin in us being able to provide that service. So we're very, very grateful that ABSS took them in. And also, one other point I'll bring to your attention. We have begun to make arrangements with the Lakeview Civitan Club to house some of our staff possibly in their facility. Now, right now, Susan Osborne has been very gracious, and we had five full-time staff at Pleasant Grove. That's our Northern Parks Division, and they take care of all our park properties in the northern part of Alamance County and run the programs. So when this broke out, we're down. We had no office space. We certainly appreciate Susan and DSS letting them come in. We really need to get those folks back out in proximity to the properties that they've been managing and the programs they run. We have a long-standing relationship with Lakeview Civitan. They've been involved in our athletic programs for years. They're located there at Roberta Drive, right off Union Ridge Road, which is centrally located for everything we do, and have indicated some very good terms for the county to put our staff in there. We're working with Mr. Albright to see how that would work, how we would put together a way to get them in there. But the bottom line is we'll know a great deal more after this Friday, but we certainly think it's going to be probably next August before that building is back.
So that would be temporary, though, that you would put them in Lakeview?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
What time is that meeting going to be Friday?
It begins at 8:30.
8:30.
Yes. And it will probably take all day. It'll be some extensive review in there. So.
And it's where?
It'll be at the Pleasant Grove Rec Center. Okay. We'll meet with the architects and Richard's staff and my folks at 8:30 Friday morning.
So is it safe to go in?
Yes, I would say so. Would you
agree? Give you a hard hand. Give you a hard hand.
Any other questions?
Are all the activities that are that were there, are they going to be able to come back in August? Or
I think it was two meetings ago. We had a contingent from Pleasant Grove that came up and expressed their concerns about getting the building fixed.
Yeah.
And at that time, I wanted to be sure we were clear to them to say, I cannot promise you the building will be back exactly as it was. I think the damage to the two wings of the building was pretty extensive. And our desire as a department is to continue to provide the same service. That may be done in a different space at Pleasant Grove. It could be done in the gym as opposed possibly to a wing. I think that's what will be so helpful about having the architects take a look at it. They know the programs and our needs and the community's needs, and I think they'll try to, in the most efficient way, help us be able to get that back.
Was that community center not available for anything over there? That little, I know.
Now we did have originally when the fire occurred, we had some discussions with Northeast Alamance Volunteer Fire Department, mm-hmm. and at that time they had Long's Chapel in there. Long's Chapel had called fire a couple of months before, they just recently, I think this is right. They just recently left the fire department, and I think we may wind up going back to them and asking them.
So that would be a good place even for the dance thing, to do it temporarily if they would let you have that on Friday night. So,
yes.
I mean, I've been there several times to that building.
To the dance.
Not to the dance.
No. I've been to the dance several times, and I've danced. It was a lot of fun.
I'm probably sure if I couldn't dance, but.
I've been a few times.
I just wanted to check on that because I do know that is a good facility as well.
That was our first thought, and they were, very eager to help us. They just they had Longs in there and weren't really sure how long they would be there.
Okay. Any questions? Any more?
Yep. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you, Brian.
Okay, the next is county manager reports.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I'd like to show the commissioners the certificate of achievement for excellence in financial reporting that Amy and her staff was awarded for the comprehensive annual financial report for the fiscal year ending June 30, 2007. And good job by them.
Can we give her hand for that? Can we do that?
And if you've never, well, all of you visited the finance department, and you know that they work in that department. They continuously are working. And, Susan, is Amy's assistant, and does a fantastic job also. Following up on what the auditor said, you have before you the five-month report, financial report in this year's budget.
Single sheet.
Yeah, it's a single sheet. You'll notice that for the first 5 months, our property tax up, what, how much is it in?
2% as far as the budget.
Property tax are up 2% as of November 30. Our sales tax are also up. Now, we don't expect sales tax to continue to be up, but through the first 5 months, our budget is holding up and we're in pretty good shape. I know there's some concern on the board, and my advice is to wait until the six-month report is in. You'll get a little better idea because we'll have some of the Christmas sales tax reports in at that time, and I think you'll have a little better idea. I quite frankly think that the first three quarters you're going to be safe, and it might be good to wait until then to make any decisions, but you know, you can always do the things that that I've been doing for the last couple of years, which the auditor said has worked, and there's no problem with that. But the budget, I think, and Amy agrees, is in good shape at this point. We think that it'll continue to be, at least through the first 6 months, and you're only 2 weeks away from that.
Yeah.
And I think you'll be easily okay for the first three quarters. Do you have any questions on this? You can take it with you and peruse it, and really, if you have any questions, call Amy or myself. We'll be glad to go over it with you. But it looks better than I think a lot of other counties are experiencing at the present time.
I would hate to be off the beaten path with this economy coming. We have two interstates coming through our front yard. We couldn't be luckier to have something to hang on to.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with you. I wanted to announce that Jason was up there, but Jason just received a $400,000 grant of CDBG. Is that correct, Jason?
It's actually a single family rehabilitation for the North Carolina Housing Finance Agency.
Oh, okay. Yeah. And that's good news for the county. Jason has been very good at getting these grants over the last couple of 3 years, and it certainly helps in the long run. The state organization has asked that you we send the name of someone on the board to be the legislative liaison this year. Every time the legislature, every 2 years, we need a liaison to. He'll be contacted by the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners. There'll be meetings, and all of you are invited to the first big meeting that they have concerning the legislature.
We have our committees assigned, and Tim has not seen this yet, but yours are the same ones you have, unless you want another.
I need to.
I am going to be the legislative liaison.
Okay, we need to send that in, so okay. We'll be able to.
Well,
send that
I'll let.
Okay.
We kind of scribbled down, and I did this before the meeting, so it's kind of. We can read it, can't we, Dan?
Yes, ma'am.
But they sent us a little form, so we'll send it in.
Okay, that'd be fine.
Let's see, and I wanted to report, since I'll be leaving, that Amy and Sammy and I, 3.5 years ago, took over two jobs each, and asked Amy to run some figures on that. And over the 3-year period, we saved the county almost $500,000. So it can be done. Of course, I'm worn out. The other two, they are in great shape. Didn't bother Amy at all. But I just want to let you know that it did work, and we're glad that we were able to save the county. Lastly, I've been asked a lot of times, you know, what I was going to do whenever I retired, and in the vernacular of the young generation, I'll probably just hang with some of my friends and maybe drive around the county with some of them on Sunday afternoon. That is Gomer Kyle in the back seat. The bald-headed guy on the side over there, I think, is our sheriff.
Yeah.
We're not sure if he was sober or not. But Sammy and I were worried. Sammy and I were worried that we may have to get us a part-time job, so we. Sheriff offered to see if we would be eligible to work in our jail, but we had a problem. we got locked in, couldn't get out, so he won't give us a job.
That's pretty good. I love it.
Look at that.
That's all I have, Madam Chair.
That's enough for tonight.
That was enough.
He told you you better deserve.
Thank you.
You warned me.
Thank you.
There'll be copies of that, Commissioner Vaughn. You won't.
I think it's going to be the same.
Only for Doc Price. Thank you.
Times needs want that, and Alamance needs.
You can take it down now.
Okay, thank you. The next is our consent agenda. Do I hear a motion that we accept the consent agenda?
Motion.
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? At this time, are there any announcements? If not, I need a motion. I have to read this. Let's see what I'm doing. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A6 to consider the qualifications and conditions of appointment or conditions of initial employment of a public officer or employee, and also to set the parameters in hiring the new county manager. So, I hear a motion.
Motion.
Another motion.
Second.
Okay.
I'm still on the picture.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. First, I want to tell you about our plan to hire the new county manager. And it will be to submit at least 5. We do have 20 applicants, and at the January 5th meeting in a closed session, we will submit at least 5 candidates from the commissioners, and we will discuss that and hopefully pick out at least 3 to interview. Any questions on that? Anybody have any comments? The next thing that I want to go to is I make a motion that we offer that we accept Mr. Clyde Albright as our new county attorney at a salary of $103,000 and effective January the 1st.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Any comments?
Thank you very much.
The next is the I make a motion that we accept Tim Burgess as the interim county manager at a salary of $99,000, and that will be effective also January the 1st.
I'll make that. Second that.
I have a second. Okay. All in favor?
Uh-huh.
All right. The next thing.
I want to ask the judge to come up in front of us here just a minute. Yes, sir. You.
Put him on the stand.
Yeah. Oh, we've got some.
The Alamance County Board of Commissioners expresses sincere appreciation to David I. Smith for unselfish devotion of time, energy, and ability to to the people of Alamance County by serving as county manager from September 26, 2005 to December 31, 2008. Presented this 15th day of December 2008 in Graham, North Carolina.
And we certainly appreciate many years of service to the county, Judge, the job you've done. And the county's in outstanding shape financially right now. A lot of it's because of you. Appreciate that.
Thank you, Judge.
Any other comments? If not, do I need a motion to adjourn?
No, you pick,
just pick that gavel up and hit it and adjourn.
Oh, we're adjourned.
We'll make a motion. We're gone.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of Commissioner meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.